everyone. This is Jennifer Curry. With me today is my colleague, Donna Glover, and we really appreciate you joining us today for our second coffee chat, which we're holding every month to discuss different topics, just kind of things, reminders, and about things that have been happening, and it's kind of more relaxed webinar, but we're really happy to get this started. Just a reminder, this is going to be the third Thursday of each month, so we're going to be holding these chats, so you can join us from the convenience of your office. It's really nice and easy and simple. Before we get started, I have a few housekeeping notes to go over. There's going to be a Q&A box, so if you have any questions, please submit them. We will try to get to as many of them as possible throughout the course of the presentation. If we don't get to them, we will answer them by email, or you can even email us if you have a separate question that you didn't get to during the course of the presentation. There is going to be a blue survey box that we're going to ask you to complete at the end of the webinar. A PDF of the presentation is going to be made available to you in the resource list. And as well, at the end of the presentation, it will be sent out to attendees in the following days. And finally, Baker Donelson has lots of different social media links, including Twitter and LinkedIn. So we ask you to please connect with us to keep as up-to-date as possible of all the things that we're sending out. We have a blog, we have newsletters, we have all these different kinds of webinars that we send out invites to. So with that, we're going to get started. We are going to be covering, number one, the FMLA basics, just, you know, for those of you who just need a little bit of a refresher. We're going to go over the top 10 do's and don'ts for FMLA. We have a few bonus tips, and then we're going to try and save enough time at the end for some question and answers. So some of the basics. Employers with 50 or more employees are covered by the FMLA. As far as employees who are covered, in order to be eligible for FMLA leave, number one, the employee has to have worked for the employer for at least 12 months prior to the need for leave. Number two, the employee has worked at least 1,250 hours in those 12 months preceding the need for leave. And number three, the employee works at a location where at least 50 employees are employed within a 75-mile radius. If the employer is covered, if the employee is eligible, then the employee may take up to 12 weeks of unpaid leave for a variety of qualifying reasons, most likely dealing with a serious health condition or the serious health condition of one of their family members. There are certain circumstances for a military caregiver leave where the employee, if eligible, may take up to 26 weeks of leave.
All right. So, I'm sorry, Jennifer.
That's okay. So our number one tip is do provide employees with proper notice of their rights. So the Department of Labor publishes sample FMLA forms on its website. There is no need to repeat or reinvent the wheel. You can use the Department of Labor forms. Although they are optional, they do cover everything that you are going to need to have in order to notify the employee of their rights. So, you know, using your own form does create the possibility that you might miss something that's required in the notice provision or fail to give information to the employees that's required under the regs. So, for example, the forms now include a reference to GINA, which is the Genetic Information Act that prevents or keeps you from seeing certain information about your employees when you're looking for medical information. That's something that should be included in every form. That is something that's now included in the Department of Labor form. And so you need to make sure you include that kind of information if you are going to be creating your own form. However, again, it is our recommendation that you avoid creating your own forms. And I think I'm sorry. I think I might have messed up Donna's section.
No,
Donna,
you're fine. You went on to number two. that's okay. We can. That's fine. We can stay on this slide and hit number one, and then we'll go back to getting an order. The number one here says, do provide employees with proper notice of rights. So a couple of things to keep in mind on this that I often find employers forget. So first of all, you have to be a covered employer to have obligations under this law. And that is a company that employs at least 50 employees and at least 20 weeks, work weeks, during the current or previous calendar year. And of course, public agencies, elementary and secondary schools are also covered employers. And you have to give people notice of their FMLA rights in at least three ways. First of all, there is a general notice requirement, and you have to do that at the time of hire, and that's a one-time event. So you can do that in a number of ways. The easiest way to do it is to issue them a copy in their onboarding packet or attach it as a part of the handbook, I often recommend. The actual poster, the WH-1420 poster, you can distribute it electronically if you want to, but that is a one-time, at the time of hire event that you have to comply with under the regulations. You also, of course, have to post the poster, right? Most of you probably do the all-in-one version, but you do have to post the 1420 poster throughout your work sites where applicants and employees can view the poster. And then third, every time an employee has a need for FMLA, you have to issue the Notice of Eligibility and Rights and Responsibilities form. That's the 381 form, along with the appropriate certification form, whether that be for employee, family, qualifying exigency leave, or a serious injury illness of a current service member or of a veteran. There is a new form, if you haven't noticed, for veterans for serious injury and illness. And you have to do that within 5 business days of the notice of the need for leave. So your supervisors have to be keyed into this as well, right? Because you want them to be passing along the information in the right way if the employee is giving notice to the supervisor. All right, Jennifer, we'll go back to three now.
All right. And so we're just going to touch again. Don't create your new form, your forms from scratch. You do want to make sure that, it's our recommendation at least, that you use the Department of Labor forms. They include everything you need to include in notifying employees of their rights and getting a medical certification and anything else that you should include in those forms. So there's really no reason to create something new from scratch unless you absolutely have to. All right, back to Donna.
All right. Thanks, Jennifer. So number three is do analyze whether an employee is covered under the 50-75 eligibility rule. So there are a number of different eligibility rules. First, you got to be there a year. You also have to work 1,250 hours prior to the start of the need for leave. But there's also the 50-75 rule. And oftentimes, multi-state employers or multi-location employers might skip over this rule and provide FMLA rights to folks who might not qualify. Some employers choose to do that knowingly. Other employers might do it without thinking about it. So to be eligible for FMLA, an employee has to also, as I said, work at a work site at which the employer you has 50 or more employees within a 75-mile radius. That means, for example, that even though you have a headquarters with the requisite number of people, you might have small or remote satellite locations where employees might not be eligible. The measurement period for this eligibility provision is at the time the employee gives notice of the need for leave. So you look to see at that moment if they are at a site or the 50 within 75-mile rule applies. So if they don't have a fixed work site, a lot of employers have remote workers, sales representatives that might be working out of their homes. So those folks with no fixed work site, the work site for purposes of the FMLA is the site to which the employees are assigned as their home base, either from which their work is assigned or where they might report from time to time for meetings or to bring in documents or paperwork or submit reports. So therefore, you shouldn't assume that somebody who works alone or at a small remote location isn't covered by the FMLA. You have to look a little more broader than that to determine whether the 50 to 75 rule applies. If you do choose to provide FMLA rights, even though the employee is not eligible due to that 50-75 rule, I encourage you to consider that carefully, because if you give FMLA-like rights, you might be subject to FMLA lawsuits. Courts have said where employers extend these rights that are equivalent to and look exactly like FMLA, then you're subjecting yourself and opening the door to FMLA interference and retaliation claims. So you should think about that carefully. You know, a different way to handle it would be that you consider each request for medical leave or need to be away from work for medical reasons as a potential reasonable accommodation under the ADA. Because if you give FMLA rights, you still have the ADA to consider. Other employers like to have a non-FMLA medical leave policy, and they might give, 6 weeks of leave. But again, you'd still be looking to the ADA after that policy leave period expires. So more of my clients these days are saying, oh, I don't want to mess with that. If the person's not FMLA covered, I'm not going to have a policy that covers them. I'm simply going to handle each case on an individualized basis under the ADA. So that is something to think about and consider how you're currently doing that within your own business. All right, Jennifer, number four.
All right. So do confirm when a rehired employee actually becomes eligible for FMLA. So let's going back to our basics. FMLA leave is available to eligible employees. That means employees who work for a covered employer. Obviously, if you're a covered employer, you have 50 or more employees. The employee has been employed for at least 12 months and have worked at least 1,250 hours within the past 12 months preceding the need for leave, and work at a location where the employer has at least 50 employees within a 75-mile radius. Now, rehired employees under the regulations may actually combine multiple periods of service to satisfy the 12-month period or the 12-month minimum. So, for example, if an employee works 5 months in 2012, leaves employment, comes back and works 7 months in 2017, the employee that will then become eligible for FMLA leave once he or she meets the other criteria that they need to meet to become eligible. So they can actually combine those two periods, even though there was a period in between there where they weren't working for you. The only limitation of this rule is that an employer doesn't need to look back to previous employment that occurred more than 7 years before the employee was most recently hired. So if you took that example that I gave you and moved the 2007 back to sometime before 2010, then you would no longer need to consider any time that was worked in 2010 or prior to that in order for that combination. All right, moving on back to Donna.
Okay, so number five, don't limit leave to work-related or, frankly, non-work-related conditions. So I often see this confusion in dealing, with clients who have folks on workers' comp that don't realize that it's FMLA eligible as well if it is a serious health condition, and vice versa. Some clients say, oh, I didn't know FMLA applied to personal injuries and illnesses, and of course it does. I know that sounds silly, but it does, of course, as you know. And so on the workers' comp side, on the job injury, it really does not matter how the injury or illness occurred. If it is a serious health condition and a qualifying condition under the FMLA, FMLA would apply. So you probably also know that serious health condition has a very broad regulatory meaning, although there are certain requirements, and we'll talk about that a little bit later in the context of a case that was very employer-friendly. when applying the regulatory definition of serious health condition. But, you know, it generally means that the employee has to have a condition that involves inpatient care or continuing medical treatment or some chronic condition. So it really doesn't matter how the condition arises, when it arises, or where it arises. If the employee has an illness or injury that qualifies, including workers' comp, then they would be eligible for FMLA. One other important note here under the regulations is when an employee is FMLA covered and the job, and the injury or illness is job related, it's also, you know, workers' comp, if the IME or their provider releases them back to work and they still have FMLA available to them, the employee can refuse, for example, they release them back to work on light duty, I should say, the employee can refuse the light duty and continue the expiration of their FMLA rights, and it is their choice to do that under the regulations. So if they still had FMLA protections and the insurance carrier was saying, oh, I want them back to work like duty, the employee can refuse and continue with their FMLA protections. All right, we'll go to number six.
All right, our number six tip is to attach the employee's job description to the designation notice. So after an employee requests the FMLA leave, an employer, you, are going to respond with a designation notice, which is going to explain to them whether or not their request for FMLA is approved. This notice that you're going to give them advises the employee that before returning to work, they will need to provide a fitness for duty certification from their healthcare employer. Now, at this point, you're going to attach the employee's job description. This is really important. And that's going to have a list of their essential functions of the position that they're holding to the designation notice. If you don't do that, if you don't say, I'm going to require a fitness for duty certification before you come back, you cannot ask for a fitness for duty certification upon return. You need to do that up front. And again, you need to attach, or we recommend you attach, a copy of the job description because, frankly, if you think about it, how can a provider, a healthcare provider, determine whether or not somebody can return to a position after being out of work on for a medical condition if they don't know and don't have an adequate description of what the employee is supposed to be doing? I mean, you certainly don't want to rely on the employee to provide that description to the doctor because obviously there's a significant chance that that description from the employee, him or herself, is not going to be completely adequate. So when you do this, it's going to require that the healthcare provider then comment specifically on whether the employer can perform those tasks that are listed in the job description. So in other words, the provider's opinion is going to be measured against a meaningful standard. Here is a list of the functions that the employee is required to perform. Here is a list that the healthcare provider says that the employee can or cannot do, and those need to at least come close to matching up in order for the person to be able to return to work. If the employer or if the provider is unsure of the essential functions of the position, the provider may rely on the employee's own report. And again, there's a lot of opportunity there for either miscommunication or an inaccurate description. For example, the employee could fail to mention lifting or driving requirements, in which case the fitness for duty certification would end up being inaccurate. So again, the point here is at the beginning, when you do designate the employee's leave as FMLA qualified or covered, then you need to put on that notice that you're going to require a fitness for duty certification upon returning to work, and you're going to attach a copy of the employee's job description to that designation notice. All right, back over to Donna.
All right. So number seven is don't require that the medical information must come from a doctor. You may know that under the FMLA, a healthcare provider is a pretty broad regulatory phrase. The definition includes, of course, medical doctor, but it also includes clinical psychologists, nurse practitioners, physician assistants, Christian Science practitioners, and in some limited circumstances, chiropractors. So we often get that question, well, how can a PA sign the form, right? Do we have to accept this? It wasn't a doctor. Yes, under the regulations, the definition's pretty broad. So you really can't, you know, question that or force them to go to a MD, a medical doctor. But here's where I want you to work really hard when it comes to FMLA compliance. When you get the completed medical certification form back, whether it's the employee or the family, make sure, first of all, that you can read it and understand it, and that every section of that form is completed. Because this is your one-time shot at the designation stage that you get to question that form. So if you don't take the time to go through the cure process, which you have an opportunity to do under the regulations, if you know they don't tell you frequency and duration of a need for intermittent leave, for example, if it's unclear, you can't read handwriting, you want to verify something, it really is important that at this moment in time you take the time to do that. The regulations say you can. You can give the form back to the individual. You use the designation notice. You write down your questions. I often recommend that you attach a letter with the questions because you probably know, if you're familiar with that designation notice, that it's just a really small box that says, hey, we need additional information before we can grant you this leave or designate it. Explain exactly what you want, which questions weren't answered, and be explicit as you can, and then you give it back to the employee. They go to their doctor with those questions, and they have 7 days, calendar days, to get that form back to you. And I call that the cure process, right? And you really want to take advantage of that, because if you don't and you accept the form as is and you designate, that is what you are stuck with in terms of managing the leave. So if down the road you say, oh, now I'm confused, they're absent a lot, I go back, I pull my form, and there's nothing about frequency and duration with respect to intermittent leave, I mean, that's going to get you in trouble down the road because you're not going to have the opportunity to then question it. Once you designate, the only opportunity you get to ask for medical information again from their treating physician or physicians is when the leave expires. So if the doc says, I need you to be out of work for 6 weeks, and you designate that 6 week leave, you are done until after the 6 weeks expires. So really important to collect the information you need to properly qualify that as FMLA leave. All right, number eight.
Going back to when we were talking about the fitness for duty certification. Our number eight tip is do not second guess that completed fitness for duty certification. That certification expresses the opinion of the employee's healthcare provider as to whether he or she can perform the essential functions of the position, again, as matched up against the job description that you would attach to the designation notice. So in general, employers must allow the employee to return to work if they supply a fitness for duty note. Now keep in mind, you can make contact with the healthcare provider to clarify or authenticate the certification. So for example, if for some reason it looks like it's not a legitimate note, you can certainly follow up with the provider to confirm that the provider did write the note. Or if there's some questions, you can't read the writing, or you're not sure why they would allow one thing but not the other, you can follow up to better understand any limitations that may have been indicated on the note, but this communication should not in any way delay the employee's return to work. And the employer generally cannot question the provider's determination. If the provider says they are capable of doing a certain function, then you have to take that word as is and trust that the employee can actually perform that function. So you would work through the employee generally to obtain additional information if you if you need it. That is that you cannot require, let's say, a second or a third opinion for a fitness for duty certification, unlike other situations, and even under the ADA, when you might be able to do so. So if an employer, if you believe that your employee needs to be seen by a healthcare provider of another choice, your remedy, and this is your own remedy, is to actually allow the employee to come back to work and arrange for a separate examination. Under the ADA, and you can only follow this procedure if the examination is job-related and consistent with business necessity. That's a good thing to keep in mind. But again, if your employee who's been out on leave and you say you're going to require fitness for duty certification and they bring one to you, as long as everything looks on the up and up, you need to trust that fitness for duty certification and allow the person to come back to work. All right, moving on to number nine.
All right, number nine. So number nine is don't require that employees return to work without restrictions. And I bet you all can tell me why. But first of all, under the FMLA, it is possible that when the employee returns to work, they might need, for example, a reduced hour schedule. If they still have FMLA time available in terms of their allotment, their 12 weeks, they could obviously use that for reduced schedule leave because that's the type of leave under the FMLA. So you would work through it in that way. If the employee doesn't have any additional FMLA time and they either need an extension of leave or they're returning to work with restrictions, now we're in the ADA bucket, right? So if somebody exhausts their FMLA, and they come back to you with restrictions, you need to entertain those restrictions as a possible reasonable accommodation under the ADA. The EEOC has made pretty clear that employers who maintain 100% healed policies, meaning you must come back to work 100%, no restrictions, is a per se violation of the ADA. So with respect to workers' comp, and with personal injuries and illnesses, you should not be maintaining a 100% healed policy, and you certainly don't want your supervisor saying, nope, got to come back to work 100%. We can't have you back unless you're 100%. That is not something you want happening in the workplace. And it's simple. The ADA does require you to make an individualized assessment of whether that employee is capable of returning to work to perform the essential functions of their job, right? You don't have to remove essential functions, but you might have to remove non-essential functions. And that's why in the context of both ADA and FMLA, the job descriptions are critical. Accurate, updated job descriptions that have the tasks, responsibilities, duties, mental and physical requirements are really important in connection with both of these laws. So, as I said, you don't want to have a 100% healed policy. You need to entertain those requests for accommodations upon return to work. And if you do require them to return to work without restrictions, that would violate potentially the FMLA and certainly the ADA if you were not engaging in the interactive process with that individual. So think about looking at your policies, making sure your practices as well are in line with that so that you don't get caught in that situation where you're requiring folks to come back without any restrictions. All right, and we are going to move on to 10. Jennifer?
Sorry about that. I put myself on mute while Donna was talking, so I didn't interrupt her. So our last tip is to consider whether to extend an employee's leave under the ADA. So remember, the FMLA provides 12 weeks of leave within a 12-month period. Once an employee has exhausted that leave, some employers believe, and a lot of you even have that we've dealt with, Donna and I've seen this over and over, have an automatic termination policy even in their handbook that says if you don't return to work after your 12 weeks of leave is exhausted, we're terminating your employment. That has now been made very clear by several courts and now guidance that that is that would be a violation under the ADA. So once you get to the end of FMLA, you as an employer need to start thinking about the ADA and engaging in the interactive process with the employee. And that is going to mean you need to determine whether you can make a reasonable accommodation for the employee. So depending on the circumstances, that reasonable accommodation could very well be to extend the employee's leave beyond 12 weeks. And there is no set formula. I know a lot of employers want to hear from us, okay, well, that means you only have to extend it for another week or another 2 weeks or another 3 weeks. There is no set formula, okay? You need to talk with the employee and find out. If the employee comes back to you and says, I just need another 10 days. In pretty much every circumstance, another 10 days of unpaid leave is going to be considered a reasonable accommodation that you would have to provide. If the employee comes back and says, I don't really know when I'm going to be coming back. I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to come back. That's a different situation. But you need to be able to evaluate those situations as they come to you and talk through it with the employee. You cannot, under any circumstances, just say, all right, your 12 weeks is up. You can't come back to work. We're going to have to fill your position. We're going to have to terminate your employment. That's no longer an option for you. So remember, once you're out of FMLA world and the employee has used up all of their leave, you automatically move into ADA land. And that's when you need to start acting like you're covered under the ADA, and you need to start talking about reasonable accommodation with the employee. All right, now we're going to move on. We have a few bonus tips we want to talk about. Donna?
Okay, so this is a good one, because we're going to talk about a case that was recently decided, actually this month, in the Eighth Circuit. And the bonus tip is, do make sure that the employee has a qualifying serious health condition. Now, earlier I said this is a complicated definition, and it is. But it can really work in your favor if you administer and manage these leaves with great care. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the facts of this case and what the court decided. So the case is Curtis v. Nucor Corp., and again, it was in the Eighth Circuit. And it really is a lesson in using the tools that the FMLA has given you under the regulations to be very vigilant about the process. So this employee, Steve, was a crane operator for Nucor, and he injured his knee while hunting one weekend in October. So it was a personal injury. He was scheduled to work a four-day shift, meaning, 4 days in a row, beginning on the following Tuesday. And after the weekend, he hurt himself, but he told his supervisor that he was unable to work and he didn't come in to work for his shift. He saw his doctor a week later, and that was exactly 9 days, keep that in mind, 9 days after the injury and after first missing his shift. This doc diagnosed left knee pain and prescribed him an anti-inflammatory. The doc then told Curtis to return if anything gets worse. That's what the doctor told the employee. So after leaving his first doctor's visit, this guy Curtis drives to his employer. He delivers a note excusing himself from work through the end of the year. But the doctor's note explained only that Curtis was, quote, under my medical care, end quote. It didn't address the four-day absence or any need for additional time off. Beyond that, the doctor did return an FMLA certification form that, of course, was provided by the employer. And it said that Curtis, the employee, had, quote, no use of left lower extremity, end quote, and that treatment would be provided, quote, as needed, end quote. However, the astute HR department saw Curtis walking on in when he delivered the note, ambulating just fine, and they decided to do a second opinion on the form that the doc submitted as the FMLA certification form. Our friend Curtis refused to go to the second opinion. The company thereafter denied his FMLA leave, said you don't qualify, and they terminated his employment. Why? Because he was AWOL for 4 days. It was an unexcused absence. So he sues, and he alleges FMLA interference and retaliation claims, which are pretty typical in an FMLA lawsuit. And the district court sided with the employer, right? And they appealed, the employee appeals, Curtis appeals, and it goes to the Eighth Circuit, which is a federal court, a federal appeals court. The Eighth Circuit affirmed the lower court's decision, and it found that Curtis indeed was not entitled to FMLA because he never showed that he had a serious health condition that made him unable to perform the essential functions of his position, right? The DOL regs say that a serious health condition requires continuing treatment by a healthcare provider as defined in the regulation 825.115. And 825.115 provides the following way that you can establish continuing treatment. If it's an acute condition involving a period of incapacity of more than 3 consecutive days, we all know that, it has to be 3 consecutive days, and continuing treatment includes either 1 treatment, 2 or more times within 30 days of the first incapacity, or initial in-person treatment followed by a regimen of continuing treatment under the supervision of a healthcare provider. Okay. The other thing to keep in mind is, and that's what I call the two treatments within first 30 days. So you have to, I call it absence plus treatment. You have to have 3 days of absence, and then you have to have 2 treatments within the first day of incapacity. But the regulations, when they were updated in 2008 now, the first treatment has to occur within the first 7 days of incapacity. Okay, so it's 2 within 30, but the first treatment has to be within the first 7 days. Nobody pays, in my experience in dealing with employers, pays attention to this rule. This particular employer did, and that's how they won the case. So either way, the first treatment or the first visit to the doctor has to happen within 7 days of the first day of incapacity after you have the 3 days, and the second within 30. Okay, enough of that. So Curtis, if you remember, he waited 9 days before he saw a physician, a doctor, under the FMLA claim, and that sunk his case. And the court said since there was only 1 doctor's visit with as-needed return trips, right, because the doc said, come see me if you need me, his injury did not qualify as having a need for continuing treatment. So the court said, nope, you're not covered. It wasn't a serious health condition. You have no FMLA rights. And they sided with the employer. And really, the takeaway is here, the FMLA really can work for you most of the time, but you have to be really diligent and vigilant in using the regulations that are available to you. And because you guys are so busy doing other things, and I was in HR, I know how it is. You know, sometimes you say, well, okay, that looks good to me. I'm going to sign off on this form and designate it. I really do encourage you to take the time to really look at those forms closely, get what you need, and make sure it's a qualifying serious health condition, because the more vigilant you are, you're going to be able to stop employees from abusing the system. So I really do encourage, this is a great case. If you need the site, let me know, and you know, I'll be happy to send it to you if you want to look at the case a little bit further. But that's our first bonus tip, and I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer for our second bonus tip. Oh, Jennifer, I think you're on mute again.
Sorry about that. Well, the second tip follows up with Donna's bonus that she was just talking about, that, you know, we know you're busy. We know that, you know, sometimes it's not always easy to keep up with the deadlines and when you're supposed to do what. But really, it's important that after you give the person their 15 calendar days to get back their medical certification, you need to follow up with the person. If they haven't returned to the certification to you in that time period. And this is particularly important because this gives you, especially for employees who aren't particularly communicative and do seem to be potentially abusing the system a little bit, by making sure that you keep up with all of this, you you make sure that you give yourself an out if you really, really need it. So I know we're getting closer to the end of our time, and we did want to provide some Q&A options. So I'm going to just go through. There's a Maryland case that came out not too long ago that can shed a little bit of light on this 50-day period expiration and what an employer's options might be. In this case, the employee was actually admitted into the hospital, and the employer was doing everything it could to reach out to the employee to find out what was going on, to get the person to get some, to fill out the forms and to make sure that her leave was actually going to be designated properly. And in this case, the employer bent over backwards. They sent out the forms. They made sure that the forms got to where they needed to go. The employee or the employee's family reached back out to the employer to tell them this is what we're doing or fill out any of the forms. The employer, you know, responded when they reached back out to them. When they didn't get a response within 15 days, they gave more time. Then they gave more time. And really the court, in analyzing the case, found that the employer really bent over backwards to try and work with the employee and get information. And after a significant period of time where the employee just didn't respond or didn't turn in any of the paperwork that needed to be turned in, the employee ended up terminating the employment just simply for lack of information and the employee not being at work. After the employee recovered, she filed suit for interference with her FMLA rights, and the court actually granted the employer summary judgment based on the fact that they had given her not only the time required under the statute for getting back the certification form, but they, like I said, bent over backwards trying to give her additional time, trying to reach out and communicate with her. The court found that there was no interference with the individual's FMLA rights under that scenario.
And in that particular case, by the way, if I'm remembering it correctly, Jennifer, I think the woman actually had heart bypass surgery.
Right.
You know, so clearly she had a serious health condition. But it is incumbent upon employees to play the game too. They have obligations under these laws, both under the FMLA and the ADA, and you need to hold their feet to the fire, kind of put them to task on it, to get what you need from them to make sure you're qualifying these leaves appropriately. I'm sorry, Jennifer, go ahead.
I was just going to say, as Donna said, you know, just like under the ADA, they are, you know, if you are, it's incumbent upon you to get the conversation started, but they are also required to engage in the conversation back. And so if the employee is not communicating with you, they're not fulfilling their side of the obligations either.
So I think we have time for at least one question because we have a minute. And Cynthia asks, can you give an example of FMLA, ADA, and workers' comp working concurrently for an issue? So the way to look at that is FMLA is your first bucket to think about, and ADA is the second bucket to think about. Workers' comp can be either ADA or FMLA. So if the employee is FMLA eligible and it's workers' comp and they do have a serious health condition, the FMLA and workers' comp would run concurrently, right? Because I think of workers' comp as pay, it's not leave. You'd still have to grant the leave, the FMLA leave. So if you're in FMLA land, that's how it would work. If the employee was not eligible for FMLA because they had less than a year of service, or they had exhausted their FMLA leave, then you move to the ADA and you work through the interactive process in terms of any reasonable accommodation, including a need for leave. So that's how that would work. Well, that is all the time we have for today. We really do thank you for joining us. We hope that you join us every third Thursday. Our next session is Thursday, April 26th at 2 p.m., and we'll be covering the results of the 2018 Maryland legislative session. I will tell you, there's a lot going on there, so we should have a lot to share, and we look forward to chatting with you then. Thanks, everyone.